Well, welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Dr. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of Teaching and Vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicagoland. And I'm your host, Tommy Creutz, and we're going to have a conversation with someone today because we believe that everyone has a story. And but before we get into that conversation, we're going to have another conversation, which we do this every week if you're new. We have something that we call the preamble ramble or the pre-ramble, where we just talk about whatever we want to talk about. And sometimes it is serious. Most of the time it is not. And today, I think, since you're looking at it right now, we should talk about it, which is a guy named Brian Johnson.
Brian with a Y.
With a Y. Brian with a Y. Not the worship leader at a church in California.
He's only 46, this guy.
He's only 46. But he is a millionaire.
Well, according to the BBC,
yeah,
tech entrepreneur Brian Johnson, 46, is spending millions trying to turn back time on his body.
Yeah.
His extreme and sometimes controversial regime of fitness, tracking, and treatments has raised a lot of eyebrows after his story went viral last year.
Yeah.
Okay, Tommy, hit me. What is crazy about his fitness, tracking, and treatment?
So basically what he has done is he has spent millions of dollars experimenting on himself to try and not necessarily reverse. I mean, I'm sure he would love to reverse the aging process, but slow it down to the point where he can live forever and not die. And this is the goal. This is the goal that he has. And so he does all of these experimental things, but have now been, I think he...
Can we just fast forward to the moment where this guy gets hit by a truck?
Yeah, right. Yeah, you can't. Well, I don't know if he leaves. I'm sure he leaves his house, but maybe he doesn't.
Dude, he's going to die of a foodborne illness or some kind of dust mite. You watch.
Yeah.
You can't. Didn't Michael Jackson basically do this? I thought Michael Jackson got into some hyperbaric chamber every night.
Oh, and there's a couple people who do that.
LeBron does the same thing.
Yeah, that's a big recovery thing. Yep.
I mean, I'm doing it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Doesn't everyone have one of those? Just in their spare bedroom? Yeah. No, I don't.
All right.
Those are $50,000. It's crazy. But he's got his own system now that he's trying to replicate so that normal people like you and me, Jeff.
He eats a lot of cocoa.
Yeah. Cacao? Or
cocoa.
Oh. Oh, yeah. Look at that. That's a giant mountain of cocoa.
Yeah. He's right into it. I'm looking. Yeah.
It's called.
So for those of you who have the internet,
check it out.
The New York Post has posted something that's not that many months old, but this guy, you have to buy high quality cocoa. And he says it's pure cocoa.
Okay. And what does it do for you? Unknown?
I don't know. It needs to have a high flavanol count. Dude, I'm giving you guys... Tommy, right now, I'm giving you the good stuff.
Yeah, tell me more about the flavanol, you know?
The flavanol account. All right.
I think that's probably the most important thing about, the stuff that you put in your body is how much flavanol
does it have? This is going to shock you that he actually sells.
Yeah. So he started his own thing now where you can replicate some of the stuff that he's doing and live forever. So regular guys like you and me, Jeff, we could live forever.
Yeah, I don't.
We could slow down our aging process. I think he's done it to the point where he is aging at the same rate someone who's 18 years old is aging. Now, I don't know what measurements are doing that, but...
what does that mean?
I don't know. I have no idea what any of it means.
Don't people age at the same rate no matter what? Or does it just mean he's pickled his body? Because I'm telling you right now...
Super good question.
My penchant for aspartame has made it so that most of my organs are going to last well beyond my death.
Yeah, it's perfectly preserved them in an aspartame bubble inside of your body.
Yeah. This guy's got nothing on me.
He's got nothing. He's spending millions while, dollar a can right here.
So Tommy wants to know.
Inflation.
That was one of the other things that you said that you wanted to know about my diet.
I do, because I said, you keep mentioning mine. And I'm like, well, you also have been on this, diet, lifestyle change, interchangeable. You
it
had
was
a heart
because
issue.
I had a brush with death.
A brush with
it. And then
And then they didn't have enough flavanol.
Apparently not. Need to eat more cocoa. I had a brush with death, and my wife and cardiologist talked me into not eating as much.
Funny story. You had a brush with death. The next morning, people saw you at the Crystal Lake campus.
Yes. I think I was there the next day.
You were.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it didn't matter. Whatever.
Yeah, it's fine.
That's my commitment to the church, dude.
You're just there.
I just keep going. Somebody said to me when I was there, I remember them saying, "Are you sure you're supposed to be here?" And I was like,
yeah, "Where else would I be?
What am I going to do?"
Yeah.
No, my change in eating habits has been forced upon me by my bad heart. Mm. And so I don't get to eat as much saturated fat.
That's tough.
So here's the thing. That's in the moment I say that, there are going to be people who are listening to me right now who are going to scream, "That's all a lie."
Yeah.
So I've had amazing numbers of people tell me that my cardiologist doesn't know what he's talking about.
Yeah.
Which is very interesting because most of the people who are talking to me are people who have only ever read anything about this from some person they don't actually know on the internet.
And one of those people who were talking to you saved your life. It was your cardiologist,
yeah,
right?
So he's got a little bit of a track record with me.
So far,
the
so
truth
good.
Is, I have no idea. Yeah. I have no idea if the saturated fat thing is good or bad, but yep. I don't eat as much saturated fat, and I'm not allowed to have, or I have to very much limit added sugar.
Okay.
So natural sugars are fine, but added sugar, I'm not supposed to have very much. But I have to go get tested for my cholesterol now and figure out whether it's actually made any difference.
Okay.
And so if it hasn't, then
bring on the cheese.
Dude, I'm just eating as much pizza as I can. It is funny though, Chicago is known for its fatty foods. Mm. Yeah.
And what would you say is like what's the best thing that's come out of this besides life? Do you feel better? Do you feel like you have more energy, more mental clarity?
No. People say stuff
negative.
Like this
all
about all
negative.
This. Yeah. No, well, like, why does everybody say that?
Yeah.
I get it. Some people are like, no, I feel way better because I'm not, whatever. So I don't get to eat pizza now.
Yeah. The only time that I actually only feel bad when I eat junk food is like, just like maybe the couple seconds after I eat it. Like,
and there's only certain kinds of junk food that make me feel that way. Like Chinese food as a general rule makes me feel that way.
MSG just doesn't jive with you.
Chinese food is one of those things that you eat. It's very much like Raisin Cane's that while you're eating it, you're like, this is the greatest thing
ever. 100%.
And then about a half hour afterwards, you're like, ah, man, that was not a good idea.
Two pieces of Texas toast.
And then you just got to wait for it to get further into your system, and then you're good to go.
Yeah. If you guys don't know that trick at Raisin Cane's, by the way, just hear it here. Learn. Know things. And do not get coleslaw at Raisin Cane's.
No.
Just tell them, no coleslaw, extra toast. And you get two pieces of their delicious Texas toast. So if you like carbs, you love carbs.
All right,
like
another life hack when it comes to there. And when you get these two pieces of toast, you say, can you bob them?
Oh.
Bob means butter on both sides. All right?
Yeah.
And you say, I need those bobbed.
Yeah. Gotta have those bobbed.
And then when you get the bobbed bread, because they'll have to call out to the kitchen, bob the bread. So you're going to get these two pieces of Texas toast that's got butter on both sides. Now, here's where it gets great.
Yeah.
What I need you to do is I need you to take your cane sauce and you need to put it on top of one of those pieces of bread.
Yeah.
And then you need to take one of those chicken fingers and you need to drop it right on top of that cane sauce.
Yeah.
And then you need to eat that concoction.
Yeah.
And try.
Live for the first time in your life.
Try not to think that this is what the new heavens and new earth.
And just remember, that's under a curse.
Yeah.
And so imagine.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, imagine I was with a guy the other day, a long time ago when I could still eat these foods, who put next to the chicken strip, the crinkly fries.
Okay.
On top of the Texas toast with the sauce.
Improvement or not?
Oh, I didn't think so, but he was pretty convinced that this was
the new thing.
Yeah.
Now, can you ever do that, or is it like you shouldn't do that often, or you can never do that ever again?
If you do that too much, I think actually that the earth will stop to cease existing, right? Because you've That's a level of nirvana. I'm not sure that's the whole world.
The space-time continuum just can't.
Be careful with it.
Be careful with the knowledge that you gain from the show. It can change.
It's like one of those superpowers that, like, when you get the, you know, in the video game, you get this special injection and you can't go too much. You can't keep doing it over and over again. You got to regenerate.
Yeah, you got to regen. So.
But it is.
We're in our regen phase right now. That's what's happening.
We're setting ourselves up. Yeah. Tommy, especially you. Yeah, speaking of regeneration.
Really, yeah. Speaking of regeneration.
There's a guy who, and anti-aging.
Yeah, totally.
The guy we're going to talk to today, I don't know how old he is.
He's probably younger than me.
He got no hair, but he has facial hair.
Yes, yeah.
He's done that, hey, I'm getting old and bald thing where you get rid of the hair on the top of your head and you start growing a lot on your chin.
How is a guy like reverse aging and I can't grow a beard yet? Isn't that just crazy? All right. You guys are going to have a conversation. It's with Kollin. He's an elder of our church. And
he's also a politician.
Yes.
So
yeah,
I'm going to ask some hard questions.
Attaboy. All right. We're going to get to the bottom of this. We're going to get into his story right now. Let's go.
So here I am with Kollin Kozlowski. It's a good Polish name.
Oh, yeah. It's the Smith of Poland.
Is it?
Yeah.
That's like one of the most common names in Poland.
Yep.
How far down the tree are you from actually living in Poland?
4 generations. Okay. So it's pretty removed.
And so who's the first to come to the United States?
It was my great-great-grandfather.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So why? Why'd they come? Do you even know?
No. It's so far removed that we haven't got into it. So family tree split half Polish, half Irish. So you get the Kollin in the front and Kozlowski in the back.
All right. Yeah. Well, that's good. Yeah. It's a good mix.
Yeah, not too bad.
You're wearing a shirt today that says Village of Palatine Village Council.
Yeah, right down the road.
So you are a politician, Kollin.
I serve the community.
No, come on now. Kiss some babies.
Yeah, kiss the babies.
Promise things handshake, you can't deliver.
Walk in parades. No. We deliver a lot here.
I am really interested in knowing how it is that you got involved in that kind of service. So I will ask that in just a second. Yeah. Are you from Chicagoland?
Grew up Chicagoland, suburb of Chicago, Elmwood Park, neighboring city of it. Parents were involved a little bit in the political scene, so got involved real close in high school. Involved and
how were they involved in the political scene?
My father had run for state representative at one point.
Wow!
And he lost, but it was the excitement and, you know, giving back. And one of the big things he did is, and I took it to when I first ran, is he half the district was in Chicago and half of it was still in Elmwood Park. So it's two different ideologies of
suburban voters. And urban.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he went and knocked on every door and introduced himself and, you know, took him 4 months every day after work. He'd go and it was a good example. Just showed a commitment and wanted to get to know the people. So, and it was probably one of the closest races from an incumbent.
Yeah.
Was there for 20 years, deep blue, and a fresh guy right out of the suburbs, you know, the neighboring city, and got it that close. So we ended up getting married, you know, moved out to Wakanda, and then came down to Palatine, and the existing councilman, great guy, but just didn't see a lot of the stuff, same stuff going on. And I said, Marge, the wife, I think I'll just throw my hat in and see what happens. And
what'd she say in response to that?
Are you sure? Are you sure this is what you're supportive? She's known that we've always been a service first kind of output and to the community, whether it's coaching football or baseball or being the president of the youth football here in Palatine. It's always something that's always been on our heart. So it wasn't a big surprise, like it came out of left field for her, but it was a lot of time, a lot of commitment. So, and I really didn't think I was going to win. I truly didn't, because the guy had been there for 24 years already, very established. And I kind of did the same thing. I went and knocked on every door, kind of took the playbook from my dad.
So what year was this that you started doing that?
2010.
Okay.
So I was elected in 2019 in the spring. So I started in winter knocking on doors, and you want to try to have people opening doors for you in the middle of winter, who you are and the climate and how everything is. So it was very challenging, but it turned out election day, I had beat them by almost 20 points.
Wow.
20%. So it was just a time.
Do you think that was a product of the fact that most people saw you? Well, everyone had seen your face at some point.
Yeah. I mean, it was something that they didn't even know what a councilman did, or we had one, and it was just
because I'm interested to know. All right. Yeah. So you knock on people's doors. Give me the oddest response that you would get. And then I also want to know what's the common response that people have?
We don't want anything. Thanks. Shut the door. You get that a lot. Pretty funny is just individuals would be shocked that, first of all, that you're coming and talking to them. And they want to talk because they've never had the chance to actually one-on-one talk to someone that represents them, their household, you know, their community, their streets, their individual police, fire, water. And they get kind of, no, you're kidding. You're not him. You're walking with him. You're getting petitions signed for him. You're not the guy. I'm like, no, really, I am the guy. A couple times I had to show him my license because they wouldn't believe that I was the guy. So, yeah. And that's what kind of spurred it on. So I'm going on.
Did you wear a suit?
No, I did not. I had a buttoned up shirt and just khakis or slacks on, and not my shorts as usual. So I did clean up a little bit to go knock on doors. So, but, yeah.
Did you have focus groups to try to decide what you were going to wear that day?
No focus groups. I did have a couple neighbors help me. I had a guy in a finance hand kind of help. Somebody helped me with the palm cards and the handouts and stuff. So it was really just, you know, four of us kind of getting
like
together,
legit running. Grassroots. This is, yeah.
And you know what? That's a lot of opportunities have probably come and I've passed up to go to higher levels or different groups, levels in the government. And I've always said, no, I do not want to do that, because when we meet on Monday nights, what we talk about, discuss, take a vote on, it's real the next day. It's active.
Yeah.
You sign it in. It doesn't go through anything else. I mean, it's real time activity and growth and what we want to do. And it's just a great pleasure to do that. So.
So you got interested in this though, mostly because your dad did it, or when you were coaching football and stuff like that, who did you coach for anyway?
For Palatine youth football.
Okay.
It was, from,
did you play when you were a kid?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I played up through high school. And
what position did you play?
Well, believe it or not, I was a receiver and cornerback. I graduated.
You're a big receiver.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I graduated. I was about 6'2", but 140 pounds.
Oh.
So I got a skin stick. That's kind of what it was. So I didn't put on the weight until college, but senior year, I blew up both my knees.
Oh, no.
There was no future going on. So I just hung around and I always had the passion for football and sports and the teamwork, the team atmosphere and how to accomplish stuff as a group.
Yeah.
And
so when did you start coaching?
When the boys were first grade.
So who are your kids?
I have three children. Gabrielle is my oldest, 28, just got married last year.
Congratulations.
Luke is my middle guy. He's engaged, getting married next year. And he just opened up the first ever tattoo parlor in Palatine.
Well, I have not been to the tattoo artist. I've been to the building where he is. Yeah. He does his work.
Yeah. And then my youngest is Grant, and he's 23. So they're adult children.
And they're all local.
Oh, yeah. 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 Daughter's living downtown, and both boys are still at the house. Luke will move out at the end of the year, and then Grant's still trying to figure it out.
Well,
and loving him.
It's hard, right? Yeah, early 20s. It used to be a case where it was a lot more, straightforward, right? And for whatever reason, jobs were easy to get. Usually, when people were younger, come out of high school, you should get a job. If they didn't want to go to college and they went to college, that was another path that was pretty set. But now we live in a weird time where
it does. I mean, Luke and Joanna, his fiance, and they're starting to look at homes, and it's just it's, I don't want to say it's out of reach of a lot of the younger kids right now, but it's going to take more time than usual. And I growing up in Elmwood Park, we came from a generation where it was multi-generation households.
Yeah.
You'd have the old three flats, and you'd have grandma and grandpa on the basement floor because they couldn't take stairs.
Yeah.
You know, the children upstairs, and then, you know, the parents.
Yeah.
So everyone lived together. It was a family unit.
Yeah.
So I have a feeling we're going to do that for a couple of years. and I love it. They're around more, and we get to interact with them more.
Me too, though.
Yeah.
So this my wife and I, because we've lived so many different places, you end up picking up values that other places have. Mm-hmm. And it is a little bit of a uniquely American thing that when you're 18, you get kind of kicked out of the house, and you got to go establish yourself, kid, and pay for everything. It's just... We just know way too many people, like I said, who have grandparents live in the house, or whose cousins live, or whose brothers and sisters live to, you know what I mean? And so for us, it's been, you know, whatever works. And oftentimes they just don't have the financial wherewithal when they're 23 years old to try to be able to manage.
I don't think we did either. It was just easier to get away with messing up a little bit.
Yeah. And well, you could, and the things didn't cost quite as much so that you could go out and do that. Now, you know, rent $2,000 bucks, and you're like, my goodness,
God, a commitment. Well,
why would you go spend that money when you could be earning money, saving some so that you can get a little bit ahead maybe and put some money down on something that is really going to help you in the future.
I do. That was the one kind of, you guys can stay there as long as you want, as long as I see you guys have a plan.
Yeah. You're working towards
you're
something.
You're saving, and you're not spending foolishly.
Yeah.
And then you're spending foolishly, you can start paying rent.
Yeah, you and I are very similar. That's right. If you start acting like a weirdo, then that... You're absolutely, but you're very welcome to be here.
Yeah.
So you coached football. Were you a good coach?
Not the best.
Come on, were you a good coach?
Best. Played all
Belichick?
The Big Tens and took the kids to multiple championships for the area. And actually,
were you the head coach?
Multiple times head coach. We had a core of about four guys that kind of just rotated it.
Remember, listen. You're a politician, so I'm going to tell you something important. There's lots of politicians who've claimed to be football coaches that weren't full football coaches, okay?
No.
So if you make some comment now,
when you get to be president,
they're going to drag this up. So make your decision right now. What football coach were you?
A great football
coach.
For the kids.
And you were a head coach for the kids?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, we rotated around. And so our kids, really special group of kids at Luke's age, when they all went to the same high school at Palatine.
Yep.
And 2 years in a row, they were Final Four down state and stuff like that. Most of them went on to play at college at some level. So very fortunate group of kids. And those same group of kids played baseball together.
Yep.
They played basketball together.
It'll be fun.
A lot of they played against like Cole Komet, who's on the Bears.
You know,
he grew up here and went to Loyola and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So it was a great group of kids to be around.
What was the best play you ran? Your go-to play. You need a first down. You can run the ball? Did you run the wishbone?
I was bigger on the run. Our other coach was bigger on the pass.
Okay.
But we'd be in third grades and they're like bobbleheads with their helmets.
Yeah.
And we'd be going back passing. And the other kids are not even knowing what the ball's doing. And we're throwing it over their head.
Oh, nice.
Touchdowns and stuff. So it got the kids riled up.
That's good fun.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So at what point in doing this kind of stuff did you think politics?
Actually, it was around the same time. It was.
Were you just getting frustrated with the way the city's run, or was it just more of a like, hey, I've got more to give? Or
I think the city was run good.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. We had done a lot of, this is going back 15 years ago, a lot of reinvestment into the towns with the TIF districts that we set up and stuff. And it was a very seasoned, I guess, older, dais or board.
Sure.
And I had the taste of being the PAFA, Palatine amateur football, president. I said, you know what, let's see if we can do this. And that's why I jumped into the local politics here.
Right.
Yeah.
So how often do you have to run?
Every 4 years.
Okay,
so I'm good for two more years. So there's.
Do you look forward to the?
No,
because that would be hard. I would always think the election signs would be tough.
It is because I'm not a person to go ask for help, donations, you know, all that other stuff. I've been lucky. My last three terms, I've ran unopposed, because I'm doing such a good job.
Yeah.
But so you don't have to do a lot of stuff, you know, ongoing campaign against a, you know, competitor or something like that. But we still have to go get petition signed to get onto the ballot and stuff. So you still got to go walk around and, you know, and talk to individuals and stuff. And they only give you like 3 weeks to do that.
Yeah.
And we got to get a couple hundred signatures. So it's and it's not like it's a at large position. So you can't just go sit at the Jewel and wait for people to come out and sign.
Right.
You, they have to be in your district.
That's
so
right.
We're split up by district. So they have to be in our district and a registered voter. And you got to have them sign a piece of paper.
Do you get complaints from people in your district frequently or not? By complaints, I'm not saying about you. I'm saying.
No. Yeah. We have a pretty good system that it routes right to me. They can go right onto our village website and send me an issue. Let's say a complaint, an issue or something they see. And it comes right to me. I'll take a look at it. Usually get it back with them within 24 hours.
Yeah.
And people, they're surprised. They think it's gone into some magic dark box.
Local government's the best.
Yeah.
Sorry, in my opinion. That's, I am a local government guy in the sense that I think that who you vote for locally matters way more than who you vote for nationally. Yep. And it's weird that we know way more about the national politics.
Right.
Than we do locally. And I, because the people who are doing things locally, like you said, the school board or the council, when they make a decision about something, it immediately affects your life. If they decide that they're going to put in a bike path that like,
start
if you want a bike path or not want a bike path, that has implications in terms of your future. So someone like me who likes cycling, I'm like, that's great.
Yeah.
Put in a bike path. And so, I just think local governance is great. And, people can know you. They can see your face. They can see you around. You're relatively accessible. That kind of stuff is really helpful. Is that why you stuck? Is that why you stuck doing local politics?
Yes. I would say that was one of the main, because I love just being part of the community here and seeing how we continue to get better. I think one of the big reasons, you know, 14 years ago when I jumped into it, we had a lot of debt as a village. And a lot of that had to do some of the expansion, some of the buildings we were doing, which is, that's how sometimes the governments have to float, because you're not going to go to the house and pay it all in one check, you know, spread it out over. So when I came in, we went, I want to say we were about $120 million in debt.
Yikes.
As a village 14 years ago. As of last summer, and we start this Monday, our budget review for the following year, we are debt-free.
Wow.
As of, it took 12 years.
Yeah.
And in that same
still
12 years.
A year.
Yeah. In that same 12 years, we built a new police station.
Yeah.
Redid our village hall, built two fire departments, and we're just redoing the new one up on Hicks. And it's without raising the levy. That's the other thing is people, oh, you're just shifting bundles. I go, yeah, it is when you have it one. We determined to put it in this capital project or this capital project. But we are allowed to levy. And a lot of people don't understand when you get your tax bill and you see Chicago's or our areas, you got 15 different government agencies that are taxing your property. When you look at the Palatine line for the last 12 years, we've only increased that levy once, and it was for $50 or $120, depending on the house. So we have, in a couple of years, we gave money back to the property owners. So that's unheard of in village or municipality politics.
No, I have not yet experienced that here in the Chicago region.
Yeah, and actually, I mean, I'm going to toot staff's horn so much. Our village manager is probably one of the top three in the state. Mm. And when there's a lot of local issues that end up in Springfield for discussion, they ask him to come down and represent the whole state's municipalities for the right way to do things, the right fiscally responsible.
Well, that's a pretty cool track record, right? I mean, I'm speaking to somebody who doesn't know anything, but if it's like 120, to be able to eliminate that kind of debt while still building some of the stuff.
Yeah.
Did you guys do a lot of that without, obviously you have to cut some spending.
I came in right at the beginning, at the end of a lot of cutting, and that's where piqued my interest, I should say, is because a lot of it was getting visible of how much money we were being spent and stuff. So we took it very strong. Our number one priority as a village entrusted, you know, stakeholder, I guess, is protect the people, keep them safe, and give them good roads.
Yeah.
Public safety and public works.
Yeah.
That's what we're here to do, you know. And
what's what most people feel, right?
Yeah. I mean, we don't need all these, you know, extravagant castles being built and for, you know, 20 people to work out of.
Yeah.
So we've taken it very serious. And the six of us up there is councilman and a mayor, who actually happens to be an ex-NFL football player, Jim
really?
Schwantz. He's been on the Bears. Oh, he won a ring with the Cowboys. So it's a very, we each all have our little niches, and we all rely on each other. No one's up there trying to make a name for themselves. We're just all there for the common.
So how long has this team, this group, been together in Palatine?
The last person, 10 years ago. So it's been the same 10,
oh, wow.
10 folks.
It's been helpful, though.
Oh, yeah.
You guys, because you know them.
Yeah. And it there's no surprises. Like, we have an issue. I know
you
how someone's going to kind of work the
all
issue.
Right, so how does politics work? You guys must have, like, lots of conversations behind the scenes.
No,
and
you
stuff.
Can't do that.
Come on.
No, it's against
whatever.
The law.
You're
it's
over
open,
your
open
house.
Meetings Act. You can't do that.
You got two dudes there packing heat, and they're like, you're like, you're going to vote this way, dude.
No, no. Actually, you can one-on-one have a conversation with someone on policy.
Okay.
Once you introduce a third person, you're breaking the law and someone can report you to the AG and stuff like that. It's called the Open Meetings Act.
So that's a great rule.
Well, yeah.
I imagine it's not honored that much all the way through the political.
I was going to say it's hard to enforce it.
Yeah.
But, you know, at our local level, I mean, even like we'll get together for a picnic.
Yeah, like
a luncheon.
Together,
huh? We'll have to publicize it that we are getting together as a group, even though it's not official business.
Sure.
It's just the key, transparency.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it all boils down to.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Never been interested in going above this, though?
No. Actually, the last election turn, this one right now going on, I had an opportunity. And
what is above this? Is it state representative?
You go to a state region.
Yeah, yeah.
County. Could as well be included. We have so many different, we have townships, we have counties, you have the state level, and obviously you have federal. It's just, and this is where I think you kind of lose, and people say there's never good quality candidates and stuff, and that's kind of where you fight. Most people are so mature in their current work, their current family, their stage of life.
Yeah.
It's hard to just stop that. Because no matter where you are and stuff, it's not, I don't say is, you almost take a step backwards sometimes from a professional perspective.
Oh, without a doubt.
And everything like that. So, you know, at a certain age, when I would have been an attractive candidate, all my kids were going to college. I mean, you can't take out of the pocket and not make it up somewhere else.
Right.
So that's one of the things they still have to try to figure out, you know, because then you figure out, well, if I'm going to make a good, you got to stay there longer. It becomes a career. And that's never what, you know, the next level was supposed to be. It was a career position.
In local politics, is there a lot of party affiliation and stuff? Or is that become more of an issue when you get into state and... Do you know what I mean by that?
Yeah,
I mean, I'm assuming Democrat and Republican, but are there might be other parties and stuff, but is it really that much of a big deal at the local level?
It depends on the village, municipality. Chicago has a lot of the D's and R's, and they run at that as aldermen. I mean, my position, depending on the city, is either an alderman, a trustee, or a councilman, or something like that. We are nonpartisan. We make that very specific because at a local level, we're here for everyone.
Right.
It's not a red versus blue or somewhere in the green or gray in the middle. It's good. And I think we all stand on certain principles, which I'm not afraid to bring out. Obviously, being, you know, a Christian in a church and being out in a public dais, I speak from my heart and what the Lord puts on my heart. But you can tell there's you have fiscal conservatives, a little bit more moderate socials and stuff like that. And you kind of know where people are leaning, even though without saying it.
But there's not, like in your position, there you would not feel any kind of obligation to any kind of party oversight or leadership.
But once you get
a little further up the line, people start.
You got to pick a side.
Yeah. And then you end up, and that has all sorts of things to deal with. Do you ever get cynical about, I'm speaking as somebody who, quite honestly, I get unfortunately cynical about it. And I probably reflect a lot of people's viewpoints, which is from the outsider looking into the political realm. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I'm not talking so much about the village politics here, but I'm talking about the further up you get in terms of the more you just think, man, people are getting these jobs so that they can have a good cushy deal in the government and
good be able pension to, and
great health care, great pension. When COVID comes around, they're always essential. Ultimately, if you keep going up the ladder, you can end up in positions where you have knowledge that helps your investment portfolio that's the cynical take. You're closer to it. So tell me where I'm wrong.
We have, at a local level, been very cautious and even written into ordinances for nepotism and stuff like that. If I wanted to have my own son in high school go work for public works in the summer to go cut grass, I couldn't do that. It's against our ordinance. It's anybody in my immediate family can't partake in anything, any kickback, jobs or positions like that. So at our level, when people come up like and say that, you just don't know how it works at the local level. As you go up higher, that's how they stay in power.
Yeah.
I mean, it truly is. And it's all the lobbyists and how they work everybody and figure out how to move it forward.
I would not be able to work in that world.
That's why I don't want to go higher.
It would just be so hard to do it. And it's all a scratch. I'll scratch your back, scratch mine. And then it goes... That's the positive way of saying it. There's also the threat, and I don't want to call it blackmail, but it's like, hey, we know this about your particular history or things that you said when you were 12 or 20, and then you don't want that to come out, do you? Yeah. So you should probably do the things we're asking you to do. And like, this is the way it works. I would just be, the whole time I'd feel like my soul's dying.
And you don't even remember half the stuff you did as a kid that would be brought up. I mean, I had at one point in the early 2000s, I had applied for FBI, special agent. It was actually in Chicago, was selected. It was like in the recruiting class.
Are you FBI right now? You have to tell me, it's a law.
Can't tell you. So it was one of the three out of the Chicagoland that made it got the letter to go to Quantico and everything, and they start this background check. And it's like, I don't even remember that. Let me get, it come out with a sheet like this, and that's like that. And, when you're running for office, as you get higher, there's whole companies that do that to get, the dirt on you and understand stuff.
Oh, so I'm like, it's also the spinning of certain events in your life that aren't quite what they make it sound. Right. There might be an element of truth in it, but it actually is like, well, no, it wasn't quite that.
You take it out of context, and the way it is now, you hear everybody wants, they have an excuse for what happened or try to re-explain it, and it just falls on deaf ears. Once it's out, it's impossible to retract that kind of stuff.
So given the system, do you think it's possible for somebody with a real noble heart to make it all the way through this?
They'd have to have a noble heart, like you said, and I truly think they'd have to have a special hedge put around them by the Lord.
Yeah.
Because it's so much maneuvering, not at this level. I don't want to say, but I see and exposed to some of the other levels, and it's just, it gets ugly sometimes.
It does.
And it's like, that's not what it's supposed to be.
Public service is supposed to be public service, right? And that's the crazy part about it, is a lot of the people who get involved in public service are genuinely, I don't care what their background is, religious, otherwise, so many are there because they actually want to help the local communities. And, they come from a particular worldview and their viewpoints might be different than mine about things, but deep inside, they're trying to do right by people and do the best by people, right? Mm-hmm. So they might not want to spend a lot of money, or they might say, well, we want to spend more money because we want to serve people and help them, and there's this gap and the government can step in and try to help.
Yeah.
I always appreciate that, that the nobility of that kind of desire, right?
Yeah.
It's just the higher you go, the number of times you have to kind of eat, you know, change your values
a little bit.
Yeah, compromise a little bit. And then eventually that becomes kind of your native approach. And the people who make it to the very tippy top of a lot of it just become understanding that it's, if you want to get anything done, it's going to have to be done by significant compromise of things. And I'm way too idealistic, unfortunately, to see all of that get done. So there's a part of me that's like, has regard for the politicians who can sit in a room together, especially the older style ones where we can sit in a room together and have a drink after they've argued
about
the subject.
Go out to dinner after. And
but it's struggled now because everything's so abrasive. The rhetoric and the talk between the parties, and it's so demeaning.
I can tell you, I mean, we do have a couple folks have different viewpoints mm-hmm. in the village. We'll still go out and after a meeting and go grab.
Well, they're people, right?
Yeah, I mean that's where it is, and it's not like I'm not. We can disagree in our opinions and stuff like that, but it still doesn't mean we won't go cycling or something together and stuff. And it takes a unique, I think, mindset to be able to separate that from the person. And I don't think a lot of people can do that. They see how someone's speaking and their tone and everything else in a political standpoint mm-hmm. and think that's who they are. No, that's an idea they have. That's what they're passionate about, but that's not the whole person.
Yeah. What's really interesting to me, I'm a big fan of Arsenal Football Club. You don't need to laugh. No. We're good. But one of the funny things is there are people who are Arsenal fans whose politics I totally disagree with.
No.
But the beauty of Arsenal is that I've come to kind of be like, oh, but there's something you and I, like if you and I went out and hung out, we just wouldn't talk about politics. We'd talk about Arsenal.
Yeah.
And I've come to realize that if you think about that across your whole life, even the people you disagree strongly with regarding their politics, that doesn't necessarily define them. They might love to cycle, or they might love to weightlift, or they might like the football team you love. And there are ways to actually get along
with
folks around those things, which is this is the unfortunate primacy of politics in our society now, is that I know, believe me, I actually really enjoy politics, love talking about issues, but when they become the primacy of everything, we stop seeing each other as humans and start seeing each other just as opponents or a barrier to getting what we want done in the society. And it's sad. So I always get encouraged when I hear about a political group that's operating kind of
how it should have been.
Well, a lot of local politics is more like that.
Yeah.
And if it wasn't, people end up knowing very quickly, right? Because it's not hard to know that Joe over there is, you know, siphoning off something on the side, and people in the neighborhood are like, nah, we're not doing that, Joe.
Yeah.
So he ends up getting voted out. Do you want to keep doing this for the rest of your days?
I we've had that conversation. I will probably run one more term for sure. So 2 years rerun. Yeah. And then that'll finish that term, but it'd give me almost 20 years.
Well,
and one of the reasons when I ran was a fresh voice, new generation.
Yeah, you'd be
the
old
voice
now.
So I'm almost at that point, all right, let's let the new folks come in and take over the reins.
Sure.
But let's make sure they understood where we were 20 years ago and how we've got here. That's one of the things is folks that have stepped away to give up or release a little bit of the control, because the village has been running so perfectly. And it's like, you don't want anything to derail it or to move it off.
Yeah.
So that's one that I've always had in my back. And when I'm ready, and I don't mind handing over the reins. I truly don't. When there's someone that is want to come in to serve the public for the public and not themselves.
That's right. If their heart's in it and it's in the right spot.
Absolutely.
Then great.
Yep.
So I have rapid fire here. So we finish. Okay. This is going to be around all sorts of stuff. Okay. You have to answer very quickly, though, okay? I don't want any explanations about it, but okay. It's okay. It's going to be around. Okay. Favorite football team?
Bears.
Favorite football player of all time?
Walter Payton.
Why?
Because his dedication, his mindset, just go.
You could have gone with Singletary there.
Nah.
No?
As for an offensive guy, running back, he hit the defense harder than most
defense.
All right,
best football team of all time. What year? Is it the 85 Bears? Is that what you're going with?
Yes, followed by the Patriots. I would say the Tom Brady Patriots. But the 85 Bears, it's a shame they only got to stick around for 1 year.
Cubs or White Sox?
Cubs, absolutely.
What were you doing in 2016 when they won the title?
I was in my friend's garage watching it on TV, having a little beverage and relaxing, and went all haywire after the rain delay. So, yeah, everyone knows where they were at on that day.
I know. I didn't even know that there was a rain delay. But then again, I wasn't living in the U.S. at the time.
Yeah.
What would you do on a perfect Saturday, sunshiny Saturday, and you could choose to do anything that on that day, what would you be doing?
I'd probably jump on my motorcycle with my wife and just go cruise in the countryside and just relax, get the sunshine and fresh air and just be with her and stop for a little food and just keep putzing around.
Do you ever let her drive this motorcycle and you ride on the back?
She cannot ride. It's too big of a motorcycle. My wife, Marge, is a little bit of a shorter stature, so I have a Road King, which is a pretty big bike. But we did, a couple years ago, she has her own bike. She has a Can-Am, a trike.
Oh, the two in the front?
She has the two in the front, yeah. So
does she like it now more?
She loves being out on it. She hates that bike because now she wants to either get a two-wheeler or the reverse trike with it.
Why doesn't she like that bike? They always look so cool.
It's cool, but it's built on a snowmobile frame, so it's very stiff steering. It's not very loose.
Isn't that to protect you from dying?
Well, that's why we first got her. That was the bicycle with the wheels.
She's like, I don't need that.
She's ready to move on.
If you could have any motorcycle at all, what would you buy?
I would have the one I have. Story I have is it was my father's motorcycle. He had been diagnosed with cancer, prostate, bought the bike, drove it down to Florida from Chicago for a vacation, came back, and he had passed away like a year after that. So this is going back almost 20 years. And my parents were remarried. My stepmother had actually sold the bike to somebody else. And lo and behold, within 4 to 5 years, my uncle connected with the guy and said, if he ever wanted to sell the bike, let him know. And it was about 2 weeks later, I got a call. So I got to buy his bike back.
Oh, wow.
So that's the bike I have. So I'm not a big every weekend road warrior ride the bike. I get out every once in a while and enjoy it and have fun. But it's more of a memory.
Is it in storage now?
It's in the garage. I mean, it's still, I can kick it up. Like today, I should have went out today.
I was going to say, you're not going to ride, though, until March.
Yeah, we're not going to have days like this again. I mean, it's pretty much put down until a good warm weather snap.
I just want you to know that I ride my scooter and my e-bike in all weather.
Yeah.
So you guys here in Chicago are all a bunch of
There softies. Are some people out there that ride it out there. Right. I'm not. It's got to be
John
above 70
Smith
for me.
John sometimes tries to ride his bike in the midst of.
I'm a plus 70 guy. You know, once I got to get out and put long pants on the bike and
yeah, you're
gloves.
Like, it's not worth it.
It's not.
Might as well just get in the car at that point.
Yep.
Kollin, thank you so much for talking to me.
Yes, definitely.
God bless you in serving.
You.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Thanks for serving in the way you do in the community. I mean it.
Thank you.
It's really cool to see when Christian brothers and sisters are actively involved in their community for the good of the society. That's why we're here.
Thank you.
So we want to see the place do well. And awesome. I don't live in Palatine.
You're right next door.
I am right next door. But I ride my bike through Palatine all the time.
Great bike paths.
They are. I'm not actually lying. It's seriously. And they repair the roads really well.
Yeah.
Oh. If Barrington could just do that.
Wait until you see the first snowstorm. You'll go down there and you'll see all these white strips going down.
Yeah.
Put the old beet juice down so we get ahead of the snow.
Nice.
Ice.
Well, yeah, it wasn't. Let's just say it wasn't in Palatine that I broke my leg.
Took your fill. Fall.
Anyway, God bless you.
Thank you.
All right, thanks everybody. We'll talk to you next time.